श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टम स्थापितम येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा गदा मह्यम ददाति स्वापदांतिकम। हे कृष्णा कर्ण सिंधु
हे कृष्णा
दीनबंधु
करुणा
जगत्पते
सिंधु दीन
गोपेशा
बंधु
गोपिका कांत
जगत्पते
राधा कांत
गोपिका
नमस्ते
कांत राधा कांत
सप्त कांच
नमस्तुते।
गौरंगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुस्ते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिय। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंदा श्री अद्वैत गदाधा शिव सादि गौर भक्त वृंदा। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो वेलकम आइसोपनिषद मंत्र 9 बट प्लीज चेक योर ऑडियो वीडियो सेटिंग्स। रूपा माता जी यू रेडी?
यस माता जी।
वेयर आर यू? आई विल पुट दिस श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य। वेयर आर यू?
आई एम देयर माता जी।
कृष्णा आई हैव टू पुट द स्पॉटलाइट ऑन यू सो यू हैव टू टर्न ऑन योर कैमरा। Here, oh Krishna. All right, so everyone ready? I'm going to share the document. Let's chant the first 8 mantras that we have covered. Please, everyone, please chant behind the mic. I will keep on sharing it on the screen and Rupa Mataji will take the lead. Okay, here we go.
Om Purnamad. I'll start, Mother. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnam Eva Vashishyate Ishavasyamidam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat Tena Tyaktena Bhunjita Magridha Kasya Svidhanam कुर्वन् एवेह कर्माणि जिजीविषेच्छतं समाः एवां त्वयेन यतेथोऽस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे असुर्यानां ते लोका अन्धेन तमसावृताः तांस्ते प्रत्याभिगच्छन्ति ये केचात्महनो जनाः अनेजदेकं मनसोजवीयो नैनदेवाप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतो अन्यान् अत्येति तिष्ठत् तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा ददाति तदेजति तान्नैजति तद्दूरे तद्वन्तिके तदन्तरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मानि एव नुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मैवा भूद्विजानतः तत्र को मोहकः शोक एकत्वम् अनुपश्यतः सपर्यगा शुक्रम् अकायमव्रणम् अस्नावीरम् शुद्धम् अपापविद्धम् कवीर्मनीषी परिभू स्वयं भूत् यथा तत्यथो अर्थान् व्यदद्दाच् चाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः।
हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे
हरे
हरे रामा हरे राम। एवरीवन कैन से हरे कृष्णा। ओके लेट्स से टुगेदर।
हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा कृष्णा हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा हरे हरे कृष्णा हरे 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 राम हरे रामा हरे 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 कृष्णा।
Simply amazing. Thank you so much. So let's start mantra 9. I hope everyone chanted. It just gets very complicated on the online preaching, but on the temple, we chant together. ओके वेलकम पार्ट थ्री. ओ कृष्णा पार्ट थ्री ऑफ आयसोपनिषद. आयसोपनिषद मंत्र 9. नाउ टफ क्वेश्चन. Does anyone know who these deities are? I don't think anyone of you will know. You can raise your hand if you know who these deities are. Nobody knows. I don't blame you. I would not have known also if I was not serving them. This is Shri Radha Damodar. Radha Damodar reside in... Oh, Sapna! Krishna Chaitanya. I missed. Yes, Sapna. Who these deities are? And Vedavati Mataji.
Probably I got it wrong because told me. I thought it's Vritta Devi, so I'm wrong from that.
No, it's okay. Hare Krishna. Vedavati Mataji. Yes, Mataji. Okay. So these deities are Shishi Radha Damodar. Srila Prabhupada installed the deed. Actually, Radha Damodar were a part of the bus party in United States. There was a bus party, Radha Damodar bus party in 1970s, where the devotees used to live in a bus and they used to go from one town to another town to perform Harinam and distribute Srila Prabhupada's books. So that's how the Krishna is called as Damodar, means his belly was bounded with the seat belt all the time in the bus. So the Krishna whose belly is always bound by rope is Damodar, right? So that's how the deities are named as Radha Damodar. And now they reside in the beautiful farm, Gita Nagari, ISKCON Gita Nagari farm in Pennsylvania, United States. So I worship these deities and I go. So I wanted to bring them to you. Okay, so Aisopnishad Mantra 9, welcome. Let's pay our obeisances to Shri Shri Radha Govinda and Shri Srila Prabhupada before we start. Mantra 9 to 14, the absolute and the relative. This is the second part of Isopanishad. Mantra 9 to 11 explains it in terms of knowledge, the absolute and the relative. What is absolute? What is relative in terms of the knowledge? And 12 to 14 explain it in terms of the worship. Okay, verses 9 to 11 compared knowledge and science and the respective designation for the followers of each. They tell us what is the definition of knowledge, what is the definition of a science. Mantra 9 discusses two kinds of people who lack knowledge of Krishna. Number one, those who are simply ignorant. And number two, those who are followers of material scholarship, thinking it the end of all knowledge. So two kinds of people who lack knowledge of Krishna is one who are so-called Vedavadratas or studying the Vedas, and the other are called Mayavrita Jnana, who think that material knowledge or scholarship is all in all. They lack knowledge of Krishna. So both kinds of people disregard the Lord's, proprietorship, and consequently disregard are degraded into the darkest regions of ignorance. Mantra 9 describes the results of cultivating ignorance and false knowledge. So we will learn today what happens if we remain either one of the two categories who are not in knowledge of Krishna. What is the destination of such a particular living entity? Mantra 10 explains that true knowledge brings a different results than either of these. It also emphasizes the need to take guidance from a dhira in the act of discriminating between the real and illusory knowledge. And Mantra 11 describes how one must know the relative positions of material and spiritual knowledge to transcend the material energy and attain deathlessness. Today we will do Mantra 9. I will set the meter, recite it twice, and then some of you may get the chance. You can raise your hand if you want to chant. But please check your audio settings before you raise your hands. Andham tama pravishyanti te avidyamupasate tato bhuyai vate tamo yayo vidyayayam rataha. I'll say one more time. Andham tama pravishyanti ye avidyamupasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyayayam rataha. Okay, Smita Mataji, please unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Mataji, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Mataji, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Antatamah pravishyanti ye avidya mupasate. Tato bhuye ivate tamoya vidyaya amrataha.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Aarti Tripathi, Mataji.
Andham tama pravishanti ye vidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyaya amrata.
Thank you, Mataji. Shri Priya, Mataji.
Hari Priya, Mataji. Andham tama pravishanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate vidyayam prata.
Mataji, thank you, but your voice is not proper. Please check your audio settings. Annu Joshi, Mataji.
Okay, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Andham tama pravishyanti ye ye vidyayam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo ye yu vidyayam yayam rataha.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice. Kumakanan, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji. Andham tama pravishyanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyayam rataha.
Thank you, Mataji. Very Mataji. Nice. Sapna. Hi, Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Andham tama. I'm fine, Mataji. Anandam tama pravishanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayo vidyayam rataha.
Thank you, Sapna. Vijay Kanan, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Antam tamah pravishyanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyayam rataha.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Surya Mahalakshmi, Mataji. Okay, I'm going to keep moving. Priyadarshini, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. She's reciting, Mataji.
Priyadarshini, Mataji, please go ahead.
Yes. Andam tama pravishanti ye vidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo ya u vidyayam rata. Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji. Priyadarshini, Mataji, check your audio settings. The voice is cracking. Girija, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Andam tama pravishanti ye vidyayam upasate tato bhuya iva tate tamo yayu vidyayam prataha.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Meenakshi, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Andham tama pravishyanti ye avidyam upashyate tato bhuya iva tate tamo yayu vidyayam prataha.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Indira, Mataji. Dr. Indira.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Om tamah pravishanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyayam rataha.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Pujya Vrinda, Mataji.
Andham tamah pravishanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyayam rataha.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Rajini, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Andham tama pravishanti ye avidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamo yayu vidyayam rata.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice. Vijayanti, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Andham tama pravishanti ye avidyam upasate ततो भूया इवा ते तमो यायु विद्यायं रताः। हरे कृष्ण।
थैंक यू माता जी। शोर शौर्या एंड डॉक्टर नम्रता माता जी।
हरे कृष्ण माता जी। अंधम तमा प्रविशन्ति ये विद्याम उपासते ततो भूया इवा यायु विद्यायं रताः।
वेरी नाइस, थैंक यू। गीता माता जी।
हरे कृष्ण माता जी। अंधम तम प्रविशन्ति ये विद्याम उपासते ततो भूया इवते तमो यायु विद्यायं रतः।
वेरी नाइस, थैंक यू माता जी। श्रुति वाही माता जी। आई थिंक हर कैमरा इज ओके। रश्मि प्रभु।
अंधम तमा प्रविशन्ति ये अविद्यम उपासहे ततो भूया इवा ते तमो यायु विद्यायं रता।
वेरी नाइस, थैंक यू प्रभु। हरे कृष्णा। श्रुति वाही माता जी। श्रुति वाही माता जी, यू आर म्यूटेड।
माता जी, आई एम ऑडिबल?
यस।
अंधम तमा प्रविशन्ति ये विद्यम उपासते ततो भूया इवाते तमो यायु विद्यायं रता।
वेरी नाइस, थैंक यू माता जी। कौरव गोवर्धन दास प्रभु।
हरे कृष्ण माता जी।
हरे कृष्ण।
अंधम तम प्रविशन्ति ये अविद्यम उपासते ततो भूया इवाते तमो यायु विद्यायं रता।
वेरी नाइस, थैंक यू प्रभु। शोभा मल्ली माता जी। माता जी, यू नॉट ऑडिबल। शोभा मल्ली माता जी, नॉट ऑडिबल। विभा।
अंधम तम प्रविशन्ति ये
माताजी, प्लीज चेक योर ऑडियो सेटिंग, यू आर नॉट क्लियर। यस विभा।
अंधम तम प्रविशन्ति ये विद्याम उपासते ततो भूया इवा ते तमो यायु विद्यायां रतः।
वेरी नाइस, थैंक यू वेरी मच विभा। ओके, वासुदेवन प्रभु। वासुदेवन प्रभु,
अंधम तमः प्रविशन्ति ये अविद्याम् उपासते।
प्रभु, नॉट ऑडिबल। वासुदेवन प्रभु, कांट हियर यू।
आई डन इट माताजी, आई फिनिश इट।
You were not audible, Prabhu. May I please request you to repeat?
Okay. Andam tamah pravishanti ye avidya
there's some problem with the internet.
Vidya.
Vasudevan Prabhu, can't hear you. Okay, everyone else whose hands are raised, please keep your hands raised. You'll get chance when we start reading. Okay. Okay, translation by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Those who engage in the culture of nisayant activities shall enter into the darkest region of ignorance. Worse still are those engaged in culture of so-called knowledge. Those who engage in the culture of nisayant activities shall enter into the darkest region of ignorance. Worse still are those engaged in the culture of so-called knowledge. Okay. Prabhupada talks about it. A godless civilization directed towards the so-called advancement of education is more dangerous than a civilization in which the masses of people are less educated. Godless civilization is more dangerous according to the Shastras. One may think advancement in material civilization is all in all, but Isa Upanishad is revolting. No. That civilization is very, very dangerous because it is godless. In chapter 7 of 17th verse of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna uses the word mudha. Namam prapadhyante mudha. Mudha means ass or donkey. okay, people engaged in gross sense gratification. Mudhas are people engaged in gross sense gratification. Ass as a symbol of stupidity. Mudhas are typical materialist without knowledge, simple fools. So that the more I possess, the more happy I am. More money, more honey. More, I have 2-room house now, I will buy 10-room house. I will be more happy. I eat in a plastic plate, I will eat in a gold plate, I will be more happy. That's gross materialist, gross. And Shastras are saying, you're a fool. Prabhupada gives 2 analogies in this particular verse. One analogy is of a cobra with a jeweled hood. The advancement of learning by a godless people, material knowledge because it is misused, is as dangerous as valuable jewel on the hood of a cobra. A cobra decorated with valuable jewel is more dangerous than one not decorated. Education has to be God-centered, so you get the jewel without cobra. Okay, so basically the advancement of education is not prohibited. The center point of education has to be changed. Right now the education is centered about I am the body and everything around me is for my sense enjoyment and I'm the lord of everything I survey. So the more I educate myself, the more high post I will be in this world and more I will earn money, and more money means more enjoyment. That is what is going on. Prabhupada was on MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology in Boston. He was giving lecture over there. And he asked them that you are the one of the finest college of the whole world in terms of technology. Where is that department who tells about the mover of the technology? Where is that department in your college? Do you have a department where you study about the mover? You know, you're working with the body and the tool, but who moves the body? What is moving the body? Do you have that department? So everyone was like awestruck, said, no, we don't. So that kind of an education where the goal is material advancement is like a jewel on the head of a cobra. Dangerous. Who wants this? Nobody. Number 2 is analogy given is decorating the dead body. In Hari Bhakti Subodhaya, in 3rd canto, 11th chapter, verse 12, the advancement of education by a godless people is compared to decorations on a dead body. Similarly, material existence is like decorating the dead body, trying to decorate it and make it attractive. But dead body is a dead body. No matter what you do, how much can you decorate, it is a dead body. So material civilization without Krishna consciousness is compared to decoration of a dead body because matter is dead. What can you do? 2 times of people are engaged in so-called knowledge. This verse talks about it. Avidya upasate, right? Number 1. Mistaken mundane educators are Vedavadrata. Okay, Vedavadrata means they are engaged in studying the Vedas, but they don't know the goal of the Vedas. Arya Samaj group. These people would engage in the study and their own interpretation of the Vedas in materialistic terms. How to go to heavenly planets and enjoy. So their goal of life is dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Prabhupada never gave this as a goal of life. Goal of life is, what is the goal of life? Nitya Krishna Das. Chivera Sarupa Hai Nitya Krishna Das. To serve Krishna. To serve the devotees. That is the goal of life of a Vaishnava. But so-called Vedavadrata, they make dharma, artha, kama, moksha, religiosity, economic development, sense gratification and liberation is the goal of life. No, we don't. Okay, in Bhagavad school, we don't. And they established worldwide institutions based on it. Their own parampara proclaiming and glorifying one of them as Jagat Guru. They say that they are studying the Vedas. And if you study the Vedas, then you can enjoy your senses more and more. And you can elevate yourself to higher planetary system. Prabhupada said that those people are very dangerous, misguiding people. Okay. Vidyaram Ratha. This word is used in this particular shloka. Vidya means knowledge, study of the Vedas. Ratha means those who are engaged. But because they don't know, they don't follow the teaching of acharyas who are in disciplic succession, they are ignorant of the actual purpose of the Vedas and they fall further into the ignorance. Those, they search out the meaning of the Vedas that fit their own purpose, not knowing the Vedas can be understood through chain of disciplic succession only. Okay, we need the Vedas from the disciplic succession. I cannot go on and validate my own misconception from the Vedic knowledge. They pose themselves as very learned in the Vedic literature, but are completely diverted from the purpose of the Vedas. What is the purpose of the Vedas? What is the purpose of the Vedas? Vedescha sarver aham eva vedya. Vedantakrit vedavit eva chaham. 15 chapter, 15 verse. Vedescha sarver aham eva vedya. The knowledge of the Vedas is to understand Krishna. I am to be known. And the second class of the people who are engaged in so-called knowledge, first is Vedavadrata, and the second class of people is called as Maya Aprita Jnana. Maya Aprita Jnana are impersonalists of self-made gods and Mayavadis. They get very, very puffed up by their knowledge. But they cannot explain how God is entangled in delusion. They say it is his Leela, but cannot control their senses. So they say that we are all God, and Krishna is also a human being like us. And when we die, we actually, right now we are not behaving as God because we are in Maya. But when we die, we will again behave like God because we will merge in the Brahman effulgence. I don't know what nonsense they say. But the basic foundation question is that if you're saying that God has come under the influence of Maya, then that means Maya is greater than God. But how is that possible? How is it possible? Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Maya adhyakshena prakriti suyate sacharacharan. Hetunanena kantaya jagat viparivartate. Maya adhyakshena prakriti. Under my supervision, the material nature is working. Okay, so Maya is under Krishna. Then how can they make up this fanaticism that Krishna has come under Maya, so he's not God now, but when he will leave Maya, then he will become God, or we all are like that. So simple people who are ignorant can become very captivated by this jugglery of words, but not the one who has understood Krishna consciousness. They are unable to recognize in their own foolishness that God cannot be entrapped by Maya, his own illusory energy. So-called scientists, big philosophers, big knowledge acquired people who have so much knowledge. But what is Krishna saying to them? Maya Aprita Jnana, because the real knowledge is stolen by Maya. They don't even know who they are. And they're trying to tell everyone. It's interesting, when we got the vaccine for COVID in December, and everyone was typing that, thank you, science. I was thinking that no one is actually contemplating that who is the brain behind this science. We can say, okay, the scientist, but who made that scientist? Who gave that brain substance to science? Why are we not going to the foundation? Why are we so superficial in our life? So this is a verse I wanted to bring up in second chapter Bhagavad Gita, 69 verse. Ya nisha sarva bhutanam tasyam jagrati samyami yasyam jagrati bhutani sa nisha pashyato munai. What is night for all beings is the time of awakening for self-control. And the time of awakening for all beings is night for introspective sage. Mane, person cannot understand. Person who is in Maya Prita Jnana. If you talk to a very big scientist and say, my dear sir, you're so knowledgeable, please read Bhagavad Gita. Then they cannot understand that how come we have time for all this when there is so much else to be done. Right? They cannot understand. It's very difficult to preach to a very so-called learned person of this world. Very difficult to tell them that who they are, because totally captivated, totally, you know, mesmerized, vashikriyate mane hypnotized, totally a madman. But and they cannot understand that how come we are not doing what they are doing, and we cannot understand how come they are not doing what we are doing. So we both cannot understand each other's lifestyle, and Krishna is validating, yes, that happens. That what is night for the other person is a night for the person who is a day for the person who is introspective. Okay, so let's read the verse. It's a small chapter, but very powerful. Let me make it big. Okay, so whose hands were raised? Dr. Nirupama Mataji.
Yes. Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Mantra 9. Andam tamaha pravishanti devityam pasate
Mataji,
your voice is not clear.
Engage in the culture of nature. Translation. Now it is clear.
Let's try. Go ahead.
No, Mataji, I'm not.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Those who engage in the culture of nascent activities. It's okay, Mataji?
Yes.
Okay. Those who engage in the culture of nascent activities shall enter into the worse still are those engaged in the culture of so-called knowledge. Purport. In the mantra, there is a comparative study of vidya and avidya. Avidya or ignorance is undoubtedly dangerous, but vidya or knowledge, when mistaken or misguided, is even more dangerous. In modern human civilization, this explanation of Sri Aisho Upanishad is more applicable than at any other time in the past. The modern civilization has advanced considerably in the matter of mass education. And yet the result is that people are more unhappy than before on account of too much stress on material advancement without any taste for the most important aspect of life, the spiritual aspect.
Thank you, Mataji. Let's talk about it. Thank you. Hare Krishna. The next will be Sapna Mataji. So Prabhupada is saying those who are engaged in the culture of designed activity shall enter into the darkest region of ignorance. I should tell you this. Remind me next time. When Brahma created modes of material nature, mode of goodness, passion, and ignorance, ignorance was the first one to be created. And there are five layers to it. There are five layers. I always forget the name. There are five types of ignorance. And the darkest type of ignorance is tama. So darkest region of ignorance is where this person is thrown. Worse still are those engaged in so-called culture of knowledge. Okay, so we don't know what is vidya, what is avidya. We take avidya as vidya, vidya as avidya. We like turn around. We are engaged in the cultivation of so-called knowledge, but we are really disregarding the most important aspect of our life, and which is the spiritual aspect. The very reason that I am moving, that I am breathing, that I am looking, I have a vision, I have hearing, I am doing so many things is because there is soul inside my body. We are completely ignoring it. So how can we be happy? How can we be happy? Always the example of a cage and a bird. If there is a bird inside the cage and I go on taking care of the cage, but I ignore the bird, will the bird be happy just because it's living in a very nice cage? Will it be happy? You can unmute yourself and tell me. Will that bird be happy?
No, Mataji.
No,
Mataji.
No, Mataji.
No, Mataji.
Thank you. So we have to take care of the bird, right? So like that, the soul is now encaged in the body. We have to take care of the soul. If we don't take care of the soul, then we will always be unhappy. Our happiness will always be somewhere else or in something else. Okay. And I think we took a vote that in this class, everybody wanted to be happy. Okay, Sapna Mataji, you can unmute yourself. Please read the next. And then Ramanujan Prabhu.
No, Mataji. As far as Vidya is concerned, the first mantra of Sri Aisho Upanishad has explained very clearly. So, forgetfulness of this fact is ignorance. The more a man forgets this fact of life, the more he is in darkness. And in view of this, a godless civilization directed toward the so-called advancement of education is more dangerous than a civilization in which the mass of people are less advanced.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice. So there's a comparison we studied in the first mantra, Isha Vasham Idam Sarvam Yat Kinchana Jagat Jagatyam Jagat Tena Taktena Bhunjita Magrida Kashyate Dhanam. What is it, Magrida? I think some of you know Magrida Kashyate Svidhanam. Yeah. So as far as Vidya is concerned, we are not paying attention to the most important element of our life. And because of what is happening is that we are only collecting avidya. We are only making advancement in a very dangerous civilization. Godless civilization is a very dangerous civilization. Sense gratification is always dangerous. It's always dangerous. You can take care of any kind of, let's talk about knowledge acquiring senses. We have 5 knowledge acquiring senses. Hai na? We acquire knowledge by our eyes. We acquire knowledge by our ears. We acquire knowledge by smelling. We acquire knowledge by taste. And we acquire knowledge by our touch. Okay. Now we can analyze. If I try to gratify the eyes, let's say I do a lot of entertainment. It's dangerous. Dangerous. A lot of entertainment is dangerous. No, it's person loses the thinking power. Or hearing. Let's say I want to hear some mundane sounds. How much can I hear? It doesn't like do anything to me. It makes me bored at some point, right? How much can we do? So then we go on jumping from one to another. And the type of sound that we associate with molds our life. It molds our life. If you remind me in the end, we'll do a little workshop on this. How a type of sound we mold with, how a type of sound we associate with molds our life. So some of you have to remind me. And then talk about eating, tongue, taste. So tongue throws a living entity in the network of nescience. Bhakti Vinod Thakur Prabhupada sings, Sharira avidya jal jode indriya tahekal jiva fele vishya sagre. The tongue has thrown the living entity in the ocean of nescience because it wants to taste so many things. It wants to taste so many things. It wants to do so many things. And it doesn't want to chant Hare Krishna. It doesn't want to taste Hare Krishna prasadam. So we are where we are. Our touch. If we don't touch the deities, if we don't take obeisance, pay our obeisances, use our hands to pay obeisances in the temple, we'll always be doing khat 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 in our life. We'll never be able to like come to the real sense that why am I given this life? Okay, Ramanujan Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu. Please make sure you don't have a background noise.
Yeah. Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
There are different classes of men called karmis, jnanis and yogis. The karmis are those who are engaged in the activities of sense gratification. Almost 99.9% of the people in modern civilizations are engaged in the activities of sense gratification under the flags of various activities such as industrialism, economic development, altruism, political consciousness, and so on. But all these activities are more or less based on the satisfaction of the senses, without any reference to the sort of God consciousness described in the first mantra of Sri Ishapanyad.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
So, Prabhupada is telling that there are 3 kind of people, Karmi, Jnani and Yogi. They are all in the mode of, more or less mode of passion. But as we go from Karmi to Jnani to Yogi, so a little bit of a mode of goodness is increasing. So Karmi is 99.9% of the people in modern civilization. Work. Study. Okay, so, and it's just sense gratification. Wherever we go, there is sense gratification. There is no limit. Right? Tamadhinam katina kalita palita durini desha te sham jata mai na karuna na kripa no pashanti. Sense gratification will never give any kind of mercy, no gratitude, and then no peace. These 3 things will never come. Who is engaged in sense gratification? Every page we read, every mantra we have read, sense gratification is condemned. But because of the weakness of the heart, it is very difficult for a conditioned soul to give it up. That is why someone has to take it. Someone has to lift us up. Someone has to lift us, and the way to do that is to chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Okay, we can say, okay, somebody is very selfish. What is our definition of selfishness? What is our definition of calling someone selfish? Definition of selfishness, please tell me if you agree with it or if you don't agree with it. Is that if that particular person is only engaged in their own self, you know, how will I be happy? It doesn't matter if the other person is suffering because of their thought process, but that's what we call selfish, right? Is that correct? You can unmute or tell me.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, but according to Sri Ishopanishad, it's not just that they are based on the sanskarification only of their own self. According to Bhagavad Gita and Sri Ishopanishad, even if a person who is a socialist or who is doing a lot of humanitarian work, they're also doing sanskarification. But their sanskarification has just extended it to other people. Because when they do that, then they feel happy, right? I am doing it because it gives me peace. Don't you hear this? Because it gives me peace, because I feel very happy, because it gives me satisfaction, because that's the goal of my life. But that is also extended sense gratification. Why is it called is like that? Because where is Krishna's senses? Where is Krishna's senses? We do what Krishna likes. Krishnendriya tripti vanchataro nam prem. So we are worried about Krishna's senses. We are not worried about what I feel or what you feel. Even if I feel discomfort, getting up early in the morning is a discomfort, but I will do it because Krishna likes it. I'll do it. That is a devotional service. That is called devotional service and not a sense gratification. So this is a very subtle difference. This is a very nice way of keeping someone in the material world. Do socialist activity, nationalist activity. We can do all those things according to Ishopanishad mantra too. We can do all those things, but we have to have Ishavasya principle, God centered in the middle of all these. Okay. Okay, we'll proceed. Kirti Mataji.
You hear me?
Yes, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji. Bhagavad Gita, people who are engaged in gross sense gratification are muddhas in darkness like the ass. The symbol of stupidity. People who are simply engaged in the pursuit of sense gratification without any real profit in life are, in the estimation of Sri Ishopanishad, worshipping avidya. And in the role of helping this sort of civilization in the name of educational advancement are doing more harm than those who are on the platform of gross sense gratification. The advancement of learning by the godless people is as dangerous as a valuable jewel on the hood of a cobra. The cobra decorated with such a valuable jewel is quite as dangerous as one which is not so decorated.
Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji.
My voice was echoing when you were saying, but you read very well. Thank you so much, Mataji. So in the language of Bhagavad Gita, people who are engaged in gross sense gratification are mudhas in darkness, like ass, the symbol of stupidity. No matter how educated they are, no matter how nicely they can dress up, no matter how well behaved they may appear from externally, we are worried about the internal. What are you doing for your soul? Is what makes us intelligent versus not intelligent. No matter what, I go to meetings and I work with one of the topmost physicians of the whole world. We get patients from all over the world. Forget about the county, all over the world. But when you sit with them, the first thing that they want to do is get some wine. So even though they may have some material knowledge about the body, because body is a machine, but that doesn't make me attracted. It does not. Yes, I am not disrespecting anyone and I will never disrespect. Krishna has given them this intelligence to understand the mechanics of body and help someone to regain their health. But the bottom line is that the sense gratification, like without that cup of beer or that wine or without that intoxication, they cannot move an inch. That's avidya, because they're not taking care of themselves. Atmaha. Remember, we studied in one of the verses, Atmaha, killer of the soul. So be very careful. Association has six principles. We can talk to them. We can take help. We can learn. But we association has six principles. Yes, what are the six principles of association? Yes, my co-host, all of you attended Nectar of Instruction. Or some of you in December we did. What are the six principles of association? Any of the co-hosts can unmute themselves. Yes, Radhika, what are the six principles of association?
Hare Krishna, ma'am. You're talking about the Vacha Vegam?
That is the person who can make disciples all over the world. Association.
Okay.
Pratikhanati.
Okay, so basically, like what you give and that is gifts you accept from the, you're talking about that?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. So, the six principles are you associate yourself with only devotees where you give them prasad and you take prasad from them.
So
those are two. Gifts you give to the devotees and take gifts back from them. And only devotees. You share in confidence with the devotees and you also hear and keep it confidential from the devotees.
Very nice. Yes, excellent.
Thank you, ma'am.
I am so proud of you. So these are the six principles of association. Is when we use the word association, it means it has these six things going on. We don't do that. We give our association when we go somewhere. Very, very careful, okay? We have to be very careful how we are walking around in this world. Okay, we can go on. Pujya Vrinda Mataji, please unmute.
Yes, Mataji.
You wanted to read?
Yeah, but there's, I think some disturbances are there. I thought you won't be able to hear me properly.
You're audible. Again, the advancement of educational activities.
Yeah, I'll do. Again, the advancement of educational activities by a godless people is, according to the Haribhakta Shubhodaya, a decoration for the dead body. In India, as in many other countries, some people follow the custom of leading a procession with a decorated dead body for the pleasure of the lamenting relatives. In the same sense, modern civilization is a patch of work of activities meant to cover the perpetual miseries of material existence. Such activities are targeted towards the sense gratification, but above the senses, there is the mind. And above the mind, there is the intelligence. And above the intelligence, there is the soul. Therefore, the aim of education should be self-realization of the spiritual values of the soul. Any education which does not lead to such realization of life must be considered avidya or nescience. And to culture such nescience means going down to the darkest region of ignorance. Such mistaken educators are known in the Vedic languages by four names: Veda, Vada, Rata, Mayaya Aparada Gnana, Asuram Bhavam, Naradhama.
Naradhama, yes. Thank you, Mataji. Thank you. Let's discuss this. So far, what did we discuss? So far, we discussed that what is avidya and what is vidya is described in this verse. Avidya is undoubtedly dangerous, but vidya or knowledge, when mistaken or misguided, is even more dangerous. Okay, so why we are living in a very dangerous civilization? Because it is godless civilization. So what is the danger of living in a godless civilization? Because we are ignoring the most important aspect of my life, which is a spiritual aspect. If I don't have the soul in my body, then I don't have a life. Then I don't live. Then I'm a dead body. And I'm ignoring it very conveniently and patching up my life with this and that and this and that. It's a very big... One can see how one is encaged in the material world when we read Srila Prabhupada's books, because it's, don't you get this feeling? We can see that how much of a covering I am in. Okay, and then we discuss that vidya means living life in with the Ishavasya principle, which was discussed in verse 1. And Prabhupada went on describing three kinds of people: karmis, jnanis, and yogis. Karmis are 99.9% of the people. Because the whole aim is economic development. If I don't have economic development, I don't have anything. Okay. As if the person who has economic development can buy his death. Can we do that? No. They can patch up, they can sleep on a better bed, they can have better medical facility, but can they become deathless? That's the main point. Talk main point. Mudde pe aao. Talk the main point. I don't want to die. I don't want to get diseased. Can you give me something like that? Anything other than that, I'm not going to compromise. Krishna will take care of my needs. If I'm going to take care of that major thing, I will not be left alone. Even in the darkest area of the world, I will not be left alone. I will always have what I need because I will be connected to my source. Okay, so mudha, so a person is called mudha, and anything that is ignoring the real profit of human life is in ignorance, no matter how they are, no matter how they are, no matter what they do, no matter what they look like, no matter how big is their car is or their houses, does not matter. It does not matter. According to Isha Upanishad and Bhagavad Gita and the acharyas in disciplic succession. And now we're going to talk about the people who are a mistaken educator. The word used is a mistaken educator. Mistaken educator are known. This is an interesting word. Prabhupada has invented some words. Like, for example, demigod. Demigod is not a word in English. Prabhupada made that. Or other words we were discussing one time, Prabhupada made these. But mistaken educator, I have not heard this anytime. There are many of you who are educators in the society. I know some of you are professors and some of you are teachers. But mistaken educators are known in the Vedic language by four names. So they are And now let's learn about Vedavadrita. Vedavadrita. Lakshmi Nishtala Mataji, please unmute.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
The Vedavadrita people pose themselves as very learned in the Vedic literature. But unfortunately, they are completely diverted from the purpose of Vedas. In the Bhagavad Gita, it is said that the purpose of Vedas is to know the personality of Godhead. But these Vedavadrita men are not at all interested in the personality of Godhead. On the contrary, they are fascinated by such results as the attainment of heaven. As is said in Mantra 1 of Sri Isopanishad, we should know that the personality of Godhead is the proprietor of everything, and we must be satisfied with our allotted portion of necessities of life. The purpose of the whole Vedic literature is to awaken this God conscious in the forgetful living being, and the same principle is presented in various ways in the world's various scriptures for understanding the foolish mankind. But the ultimate purpose is to bring one back to the Godhead. But the Vedavadrita people, instead of realizing the purpose of the Vedas, take it for granted that side issues such as the attainment of heavenly pleasures for sense gratification, the lust for which the very cause of the material bondage in the first place, is the ultimate end of the Vedas. Such people misguide others by misinterpreting the Vedic literature, and sometimes they condemn the Puranas, which are authentic, powered by illusion. The self-made gods cannot answer all these questions very clearly, but they are satisfied that they have become God themselves.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Okay, so this particular verse, we studied about two of the such mistaken educators. One is Vedavadrita and another is Mayavrita Jnana. Before Vedavadrita, all this description was for Mayavrita Jnana. Advancement of educational activities by a godless people is, according to Hari Bhakti Subodhya, a decoration of the dead body or a jeweled cobra, a jeweled ornament on the head of a cobra. It's dangerous. Because it's not going to solve the real problem. It will give me some patchwork. Okay, I fractured my leg. Okay, then put a cast and then you will heal. Thank you very much. But can you please tell me, how did I get to this body where I had to have this kind of a leg? And I had to walk on such dangerous roads? No, that they don't know. Just patch up, patchwork. Karlo. One very, very, very elder devotee, Prabhupada disciple, gave class one time in the temple. I think it was 2017. I was there in Philadelphia. And he was talking about this patchwork. See, if I'm growing old, then patchwork is there, no? In the science, get Botox injections and get rid of the wrinkles, or put anti-wrinkle cream, or the hair are growing gray, then put a patch, patch it up with the. But the main thing is, I don't want to grow old. I don't want to do all that. So that we don't know. That we know, because we know. Or the advertisements that nowadays, if you don't put mascara in your eyes, then your eyelashes have no value. No value. Oh, you didn't, or the extension, or what is it called? The eyelash. Or if you don't put that, and if you don't blink up and down like that, no value. That's a patchwork. That's patchwork. Because we want to look beautiful, because that's the nature of the soul. The soul is very beautiful. The nature of the soul is to look beautiful. The nature of the soul is to feel happy. The nature of the soul is to be blissful, to be full of knowledge, to not to have anxiety. But we are looking for it in a wrong place. We got to stop that and look in the right place. And also Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita, all the Shastras are very loudly chanting, talking, shouting, revolutionizing our life. Look in the right place. Chant Hare Krishna. And then they give us warnings. These are the warnings. Don't follow this person. Don't follow this person. Follow the acharyas. Okay, so let's see. Questions. I'm going to lower all the hands. Very nice mantra, right? Very nice mantra that avidya. Avidya definition is given in this mantra. Please don't mind. I'm lowering all the hands so buzz around can start. And also, I have one very important announcement. I need 4 devotees from this class who can chant Bhagavad Gita verses on Thursday for Ekadashi, for 700 verses. I have been given chapter 10 and 11 to find devotees. So please, who has not participated even one time, please send me the recording of your first 5 verses to my email. Not on WhatsApp. You will never get a reply from me if you send me a private message on WhatsApp. That's not how I operate. I have over 50 groups from temple in WhatsApp. So it's very dangerous for me. So please send me an email if you are interested with the first 5 verses of chapter 10 or 11, preferably today or latest by tomorrow morning. Preferably today, because if you send it to me today, then I'm done. I already chose who is going to sing that day. First 5 verses, email. If you WhatsApp, then it's gone. And please don't blame me because I can't manage so much. Okay, ready for questions? Explain the analogies used in Mantra 9 to describe the so-called educated human being. Somebody is writing me something. Mataji, can I, or the one who are not interested? Sapna, you're my backup. Where are you? Yes, Apna. You're my backup. In case I don't get any new people, then I'll come to you. Smita Mataji.
Okay, Mataji.
Okay. Smita Mataji, unmute yourself to answer the question.
I'll have to crave. No. You have to give me a few seconds.
Okay. Explain the analogies used in Mantra 9 to describe the so-called educated human beings.
Mataji, my hand was raised for something else. So you just give me time. Yeah. I forgot. Okay. No, I wanted to talk something about it.
Okay. You know, Mataji. Rajni Mataji, yes. What are the 2 analogies?
Yes, Mataji. One is cobra with the jewels on the head. And second is decorating the dead body.
Very nice. Anyone else? Very nice. Explain a little bit more, someone else. Girija, very nice, Mataji. Girija, Mataji, unmute, please.
Yeah, cobra with jeweled hood, it means education has to be God-centered. Then you get the jewel without the cobra. Otherwise, if you are only thinking about the jewel with the cobra, then it is more dangerous.
Very nice. Thank you. Meenakshi Mataji, do you want to explain decoration of a dead body?
Yes, Mataji. So decoration of dead body is like the dead body is dead body. If you decorate it, then also it will not have any difference. It is a dead body. So it is like, you know, you are learned, but you are not God-centered. So that kind of learning is compared to this. So if we are learned, but we are keeping God in the center, that is actual learning. That is actual vidya. Otherwise, everything is avidya or darkness.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Anvya, Mataji, what did you want to say?
Mataji, same thing.
Okay. Thank you. Why is godless civilization dangerous according to Mantra 9? Why is it dangerous? What's the problem? Eat, drink, be merry, go to a big college, get a degree, get a job. What is so dangerous about it? Yes. What is so dangerous? Only one person raised the hand. Nakshi Mataji, you can unmute.
So Mataji, it is dangerous because it deviates us from the path of self-realization. It does not tell us about, like, you know, the aim of our life is self-realization, but it takes us to a different path. So we deviate from our actual purpose of realizing self, of serving God. So that is why it is dangerous.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Yes, Rashmi Prabhu, what is so dangerous about it?
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Basically, it's leading us astray from self-realization and taking us towards the darkest region of ignorance.
Very nice. Thank you very much. See, so simple, but so profound. Yes, Geeta Mataji.
Yeah, any knowledge, Hare Krishna Mataji, any knowledge that is misguided or mistaken is very dangerous. That is, if we don't understand it properly and it is not God-centered, it is very dangerous. Just as we said, Prabhupada said, godless activities which has advancement in our civilization is like decorating the decorating a dead body. Like,
very nice.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Very nice, thank you. Yes, Vibha.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Mataji, the reason is that if we are, why godless civilization is dangerous is that we will get into the mode of ignorance.
Okay, very nice. So what will happen with that?
We'll get into all such bad activities.
Which will take you away from Krishna or near to Krishna?
No, it'll take away us from Krishna. Yeah.
So what should you do since you are in 8th grade, right? You are in 8th grade. So what ninth should you do? Mataji. Because a 9th grade, chala 9th grade, very high grade. So what you should do? So let's say that material civilized education is so dangerous. So should you give up your school? Or what you should
Mataji. No, because Mataji, school education gives us knowledge. Like it gives us good knowledge. We learn more interesting things in it. It gives us more knowledge. Whereas if we get into the mode of ignorance, we get into all such activities that are not needed.
Very nice. Thank you, Vibha. So this is a very commonly asked question. Vasudevan Prabhu, you wanted to say something?
Yes. What I want to say is the godless civilization is totally confined to material advancements. And it rarely or has not taken botheration to think in an advanced way and get itself connected to the God, the Creator. It has rarely done that. Rarely, why I should say it has not. It has not done that at all. And therefore, it is confined totally to the material part of it. And it doesn't think beyond that. There is something beyond that. What is that? Who am I? Who has created me? And that sort of thinking has not got into this civilization. That is dangerous.
Yes. Thank you, Prabhu. Very well. Very well said. And if you don't know, Dr. Vasudevan Prabhu is a retired geologist of India, one of the famous geologist of the country. So he's not an ordinary man. Even if it is coming from an ordinary man, it is still perfect. But it is coming from an experience of both the worlds. Okay, so so my question, which I'm very commonly asked, I'm going to bring up that, okay, so if the material civilization or material education is so dangerous, so should we not go to the schools and colleges? That's the question I'm asked a lot. Actually, that is a sign of a Kanishtha. If somebody thinks like that, then I should not go to the school and college because it is so dangerous, then that is a sign of a neophyte devotee, has not understood the essence of Krishna consciousness. Because the Krishna consciousness is not about not doing something. Krishna consciousness is about doing everything in with Krishna consciousness. We're putting Krishna in the center. A devotee of Krishna will go to the college and will be very, very conscious that I am first of all here in this particular body because of Krishna's mercy. And then I am given this intelligence to get this knowledge because this intelligence and memory, everything is given to me by Krishna. So and this material thing is a material thing until and unless I use it for Krishna's service. So that person will work even harder. Not that they will not go. They will go and work even harder because now they are studying it to give it to Krishna. Okay, they will have a lot of sense of responsibility. The Washington, D.C. temple, ISKCON temple in Washington, D.C. in America, the temple president is an anesthesiologist. And he is the vice, vice chairperson of anesthesia department in his hospital. So he's not only the temple president, but he's also an practicing physician and also holding a high administrative position. How do they do that? It's not a joke. How do they do that? Right? How do they do that? Because they have understood. And because of their position, they're able to influence so many people and say that, see, it's Krishna's mercy. Prabhupada, we can take example, best example. Prabhupada can be the number one businessman of any of the ages, number one. The way he entered the temples in the duration of time that he entered, no one has done it in the history. There has been enough research on this, how Prabhupada started ISKCON. Okay, no one has done it. They have gone as far as 2000 BC and they have not found anyone else other than Prabhupada. What Prabhupada is unmatched opulence of Prabhupada. But Prabhupada has done it in a God-centered way. Prabhupada's best disciple, one of the best disciples is Swarup Damodar Goswami. Swarup Damodar Goswami was a PhD scientist from Stanford University, California. And Prabhupada told him, start Bhaktivedanta Institute in Calcutta and teach people the science of Krishna. He started it. It's there. Okay. Okay. Any questions? Thank you everyone for participation. So please read it again. And please try to take Krishna consciousness seriously in your life. Any questions? Yes, Khushbu.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Mataji, my question is, how can you help me, or rather generally, to as a teacher, if I'm teaching my students, so how can I, offer the teaching to Lord Krishna while I teach?
That's a skill, Khushbu. You may not be able to do direct preaching because you may not be allowed by the administration that you're in. Okay, but that's a skill. At least you can incite a consciousness. You can incite a curiosity. I'll give you one example. Darwin's theory of evolution, is it still taught in the schools?
Yes.
So it's a very mistaken theory of evolution. If I am teaching in school, okay, and actually my best friend is a school teacher and she's such a nice devotee. And she connects with students in personal level and she shows me today morning also, she was talking to me and telling me that how these people and these children in school are connecting so well to her. So when the children get connected to you personally, then that's different ball game. But in general, let's say this Darwin's theory of evolution. So what is this Darwin theory of evolution said? That the human beings are the descendants, the descendants of human beings are monkeys, right? Chimpanzees, that's what it says.
Yes, Mataji.
So if I'm teaching this, okay, well, by the way, you have to study this to pass your exam, but the practical application of the theory, is it real? It's a theory. It's not a fact. It's not proven. Number one. Number two, when he has said that the monkeys have evolved into humans, then why are they coexisting? Why are they coexisting? Because all the monkeys have evolved into humans. So why is we have monkeys also and humans also? And number three, Darwin's theory of evolution does not talk about life after death. It does not talk about transmigration of the soul. So you can incite the curiosity. You can just give them, and if the student is intelligent, then they'll come to you personally. Then you can connect with them. Okay.
Okay.
It's a skill. It's a skill to bring Krishna in your classroom. I bring it. It's a skill. I'm not very skillful, but I... the other day we were talking about, I don't know what we were talking about. I have my postgraduates and a medical student. We were sitting and I was talking to them about something. And then we said, okay, so, alcohol. So I don't do adult medicine, right? But these, they were family medicine residents and they're telling me alcohol withdrawal syndrome. And they were telling me the stages that when a person withdraws from alcohol, then what are the different stages and how do they treat? And I said, whoa, so what do you do with them after they withdraw? Said, oh, we send them to rehab. So what happens after they come out of the rehab? So we were talking about, okay, what is the data showing that are they really giving it up? So my senior said, no, they don't. They take it again. It's like, you know, you drink and then you get these things and then you come to us in the hospital and then we treat you. Then we send you to rehab and then you start again. And I said, okay, what do you think about these sexually transmitted diseases? What do you think about that? I said, yeah, just go do whatever you want in the world. Come to the urgent care or emergency room, get one penicillin injection and then start again. So there is she used the word treatment. And I said, that's not treatment. That's like a patchwork. It's a patchwork. That's not treatment. Treatment is treating the cause. And the cause is impurity in the heart. That's not treatment. So we all agreed. Okay. And I ended up giving her Bhagavad Gita. She's an American student. So that's different. But because I have rapport with them, I work with them, right? Okay. So it's a skill, Khushbu. It's a skill.
Okay. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.